If the U.S. revokes the Hong Kong Policy Act and other countries follow suit with similar measures, how would that affect Hong Kong, and especially will the Hong Kong dollar collapse?
That's a very big issue. The Hong Kong is a special administrative region of China, but what makes it special is the foreign recognition of that. The fact that other governments, including the U.S., recognize us as in Hong Kong as a separate customs and trade and tax and legal jurisdiction. And so there are no duties on Hong Kong exports, for example, into many countries. If we were simply lumped in with the rest of the mainland of China because of the increasing level of control by the mainland government, then it would severely damage the economy. We would no longer have those trade benefits. Our various agreements would have to be nullified. For example, the air traffic agreements, where we have our own negotiations on takeoff and landing slots at the airport, and bilateral agreements with other countries on routes. And so at that point, if China loses all of the benefits that Hong Kong has by having special treatment under the U.S. Hong Kong Relations Act and with other countries, then they don't really have much reason left to maintain Hong Kong as a special region. And so it may just be that they say at that point, well, we're going to accelerate the destruction of the one country, two systems model. So that's a threat. I hope it doesn't happen. But this goes on, the extradition bill and possibly national security legislation that follows that, all of this tightening of the grip on Hong Kong happens at the same time as a financial or trade war with the US. And so it's possible at some point that Mr. Trump decides to include Hong Kong's status as a bargaining chip or weapon in that trade dispute. And say, well, we think that lots of Chinese exports are coming through Hong Kong and being relabeled or something, and we producing some kind of excuse that allow him to get Congress to revoke Hong Kong's separate status. The Hong Kong dollar you asked about is part and parcel of the one country, two systems model, because we have our own monetary authority, our own foreign reserves, and their own currency, which is pegged to the US dollar since 1983. And that's only really useful as long as it's a separate administrative region. If we become part of mainland China, then sure enough, we'll end up adopting the RMB as the domestic currency as well.
So the Hong Kong dollar will disappear?
Over time it would, yeah. We're pegged to the US dollar. It's possible that within the basic law structure, that peg could be removed and we could re-peg to a different currency, including the Chinese yuan. The reason that hasn't happened so far is that the RMB or Chinese yuan is not an international currency. It's subject to very severe capital controls. And so that's incompatible with our status as an international capital market.
Do you have any idea on the scale of the Red family's assets in Hong Kong, including stocks, real estate, and other investments?
No, I can't give you an estimate of that because it's top secret, and I don't know it.
But what about your gut feeling?
No, they there is a point in saying that the officials, their relatives, senior officials' relatives, probably have quite extensive investments through Hong Kong. Sometimes those are out and back, they're into Hong Kong and then back to the mainland, controlling shares in mainland companies. And they do have various reasons to want to keep Hong Kong's separate tax status. For example, I think the two wealthiest tycoons in China now, Pony Ma and Jack Ma, are probably both Hong Kong permanent residents. They have big houses in Hong Kong and probably spend less than 180 days a year in the mainland, which means that they're not subject to personal tax in the mainland. And the princelings likewise, I think they have a lot of interest here, which means that there is a reason for Beijing to want to keep Hong Kong's special status. But whether that overwhelms, or whether that is a big enough reason compared to their current priorities on sovereignty and national unity and control, that's another question. I think that Xi Jinping is more interested in control at all costs, if that does mean losing the special status.
You know, there have been speculations going around that some people are getting ready to short sell the Hong Kong dollar, foreseeing what could happen to Hong Kong's financial market. What do you make of it?
I haven't seen any basis for that. If anything, the Hong Kong dollar has strengthened slightly in the last few days, and it's lasted since 1983, and there's a very substantial amount of assets available to defend any short selling against it. So I think that idea emerges from time to time, usually promoted by a small hedge fund manager. That's what started this current wave of speculation. And they think they've discovered something new and they want to be the next George Soros who breaks the Bank of England and so on. But that's a very rare event, and I don't see any why the bank would break through short selling.
So you have heard the speculation and you think this is nonsense?
Yes, I don't think they have the firepower. You would need hundreds of billions of dollars US to make a meaningful attack on the peg. I don't think that's going to happen.
Okay.
The peg may break for political reasons at some point. Maybe a decision of the government to let it go, but that's not on the horizon right now.
So do you think the central government for mainland China would intervene if someone tries to do something like that?
I don't think they would need to. Hong Kong has enough reserves of its own to defend its currency board.
I see.
Have you seen a large amount of Prince Ling's money and investment fleeing Hong Kong?
I would have no way of knowing whether they're arriving or fleeing.
Okay.
I'm not a private banker. Go and call a private banker.
All right.
If the Hong Kong government refused to terminate the extradition law, and thus the US and other countries revoke their recognition of Hong Kong's special financial and trade status, and Hong Kong falls financially, do you think this could serve as a fuse that could lit the fire that could burn down the Chinese communist regime altogether?
I understand what you're saying, but the mechanics don't work that way. Hong Kong is only about 0.5% Chinese population, 7 million people out of 1.4 billion. We're only a few percent of Chinese GDP, and what happens here will not be enough on its own to destabilize the mainland government. There are bigger threats to the mainland economy in the long run, which is the fact that they're still trying to micromanage everything and centrally plan it. And there's no large-scale economy on Earth that has successfully delivered sustainable prosperity through central planning. Communist China tried it from 1949 to 1979. The USSR tried it. Smaller places like Cuba and North Korea have tried it. And the UK, even with a high degree of national ownership, tried it in the 1960s and 70s. There was a very socialist economy that I grew up in the 1970s in the UK, when the government controlled the airlines, electricity, water, aerospace. They had a lot of national enterprises, state-owned enterprises in the UK, and it wasn't working at all. And it only became prosperous under Margaret Thatcher when she decided to sell off the state-owned enterprises and pursue free market principles. Those are the ones that work. They're tried and tested. So the bigger threat to the Chinese government is itself, basically, to the Chinese economy, that eventually the economy will stall. They've been masking their failures for some years now by extending more and more credit, building up a credit bubble, and to finance projects which are not economically viable, and building more and more infrastructure, some of which was needed because there had been a long time when there was no real investment in things like airports and railways and exhibition centers. But beyond a certain point, you are not generating any benefits. You're simply sinking money into the ground, and eventually that has to be paid for. So the what will eventually bring change in China, hopefully peacefully and hopefully top down. There might be some new leadership that emerges and recognizes free market principles as the way forward, and gradual democratization as well for accountability. China would become an open and pluralistic society. If a top down reform doesn't deliver that, then eventually the people will realize what's going on and want to reform it themselves.
So you think whether Hong Kong stands or falls won't have a big impact on China's economy?
The future of the Chinese economy as a whole depends on central government reform and their policies. And they can't carry on pretending to reform and talking about deepening reforms and letting the market play a greater role when at the same time they are actually interfering more and more, requiring companies to set up Communist Party committees, for example, that must be consulted on every major decision. And, they're actually tightening their grip on the economy over the last few years. Eventually that will break. And within the time frame of the basic law in Hong Kong, which is promised to extend at least until 2047, I think that by 2047, China will have to be in a prosperous, open, democratic society. Otherwise, between now and then, it will have an economic crisis, and that will bring that change.